Sorry about that. I didn't realize there was the same problem we did. Is it? Okay, perfect. I trust you. I don't have to check. Okay. So, first of all, we have to see what type of limit this is. So we will have to plug it in. Where does the top go?
Zero.
Perfect. Where does the denominator go?
Zero.
Excellent. So this is a friendly situation. Remember how we differentiate e to the x. It's e to the x times natural log e, but this is 1. How do I differentiate 5 to the x? Five to the x times natural log, exactly, five. Now if I have 5 to a function prime, it's 5 to the function times natural log 5 times the function prime. But this is just plain x. So when I differentiate, let's say, let's start with a denominator, I have to write 5 to the x times natural log 5. And the negative 1 prime is 0. Now the top is a product of two functions. The first function prime, 1, 5 to the x, minus, this is a plus. I'm sorry, we are not differentiating using the quotient rule. This is L'Hopital's rule. So the top function prime is 1 times the second one plus the first one times the second one prime, which is 5 to the x times natural log 5. I notice that the top and the bottom have a common factor. I need to get rid of that common factor, which is happens to be 5 to the x. So I can make it as simple as possible. X approaches 0, 5 to the x, 1 plus x natural log 5 over 5 to the x natural log 5. Thank you. And now I have to check again. I cannot just say, oh, let's apply L'Hopital's rule again. No, 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 no. I have to make sure that it's still 0 over 0 or infinity over infinity. So when x approaches 0, the numerator goes to 1. When x approaches 0, the denominator goes to natural log 5. So this is it. It's not 0 over 0 or infinity over infinity. So therefore, it's done. So in one step. Is this clear? Felix? Perfect. So please remember those formulas. It's easy to remember if you remember this. This should have been e to the x prime is e to the x times natural log e, but we don't because it's 1. But if it's any other number, I have to have natural log of that number because it's not 1. Okay, so let's find something like that. So back to 4.4. So we can choose any other function you want. Yes, indeed, that was 62. So let's choose another with natural log, etc., etc., etc. Any preference? Which one? Okay, 64. Did we do 64? No. Okay, perfect. 64 it is. And 64 on page 308. We're looking at limit as x approaches 1 from 2 minus x raised to tangent pi x divided by 2. Okay, how do I start? What is the first step? Yes, so let's plug 1 in. I'm ready. Yes. So we get 1, 2. Okay. So how much is tangent pi over 2? Well, that's infinity. Yeah. Actually, it's d and e because it approaches 1 from either side. But it's 1 to infinity. Okay. Good. Next step. When we see that, which is a power, one of the power, the three possibilities, 0 raised to 0, 1 raised to infinity, and infinity raised to 0, then we know that we have to go through the whole process. Which process? Denote the function by y. Then, natural log y equals tangent pi x over 2 times natural log of 2 minus x, perfect. Then what?
Differentiate.
Very good. So let's differentiate. Oh, no, we're not differentiating. Sorry. We have to apply limit. So the next step is to apply the limit. So let's apply the limit. So limit as x approaches 1 from natural log y equals limit as x approaches 1 from tangent pi x over 2 multiplied by natural log 2 minus x. Now I try again. Where does this go? Where does this go? Zero. So we have accomplished a lot. We changed the ugly power into a product. And the product is very easy to manipulate. I shouldn't say very, but it's easier to manipulate. I need to manipulate this product. I have limit as x approaches 1. How do I change it? Perfect. You mean cotangent? Yes. So natural log 2 minus x over cotangent pi x. Excellent. Because 1 over cotangent is the same with tangent. Great job. Good. So now we try again. The numerator goes to same thing, right? Now what about the denominator? Cotangent pi over 2. Cotangent is cosine over sine, and so this will be cosine of pi over 2 over sine pi over 2. We know that this is 0 and this is 1. So the denominator goes to, very good. So after all this work, it pays off, it's 0 over 0. Good. What now? Yes, the top prime, and then the denominator prime. Careful, times?
Negative 1.
Now, careful of this cotangent. I don't like it. But since I can, when I differentiate cotangent, I get negative cosecant squared pi x over 2 times the inner function prime, which is pi over 2. If it were something else, you may have considered changing it into sine over cosine, in this case, cosine over sine. Who knows? So keep that in mind. But it works. out well right now, because cosecant is one over sine. So when x approaches 1, this is 1 over sine squared, but it's still 1 over sine, and it approaches 1. So this whole thing will approach 1. The numerator, the whole thing will approach what? When t approaches 1? Negative 1. Right? Ah. There is no t. All of a sudden, my head turned from x to t. I'm sorry. Of course, x. Thank you. Sorry about that. So the top goes to negative 1. This goes to 1. And this is pi over 2. So then the numerator is negative 1. And the denominator is negative pi over 2. Of course, I have to flip. It's 2 over pi. So now I copy the beginning. And I copy the last step. And I draw a conclusion then. So let's copy the beginning and the last and the end. So limit as t approaches 1 from natural log y is 2 over pi. Under continuity, I'm allowed to swap. So natural log of x approaches 1 from y is 2 over pi. So the question is, what can this be? So that the answer is 2 over pi. And there is only one answer possible. The answer here is e raised to 2 over pi. So that is limit of 2 minus x raised to tangent pi x over 2 when x approaches 1. So as you saw, 1 raised to infinity turned into e raised to 2 over pi. And I would not believe that you would have thought of that outcome. Okay. So now we want to look at one more Newton's method, and then work on optimization. Ready?
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay, so let's say number 17. I don't think we did 17. Please correct me. 17 on page 342, which is 3 cosine x equals x plus 1. Did we work on this problem? Okay, perfect. So we're asked, it says, correct to 6 decimal places. 6 decimal places. Okay. What is the starting point? If the problem is asking you to find 5 solutions or 3 solutions, just find one. I'm happy with that. And I'll give you the points. I only need one. Because if you know the procedure for one, you'll know the procedure for the other. Okay, so then? Yes, create the function. Excellent. Set equal to 0. Indeed. So 3. Cosine x minus x minus 1 equals 0. And this is our f of x, which is 3 cosine x minus 1. And we should find f prime right here, right now. Negative 3 sine x minus 1. Because we are going to use it. Perfect. So I set it equal to 0. I created the function. I found the derivative. What is the next step? Remember, I need an interval where the solution is. So I have to put the function in the graphing calculator. And what do I do with that? I will be using the intermediate value The intermediate value, what? Theorem, very good. The intermediate value theorem. So in y equals, clear if you have anything else. And let's punch in 3 cosine x. Make sure your mode is in radians. Minus x minus 1. Is it clear what we're doing now? We have to find that open interval. Okay, so we go to second and table. I have no idea where to start, but I'll start small. Like, and make sure again that your mode is in radian. So second and table. I'm gonna say, I already see, I can cheat. You cannot cheat because you don't have the graph. But let's say I don't see that. I don't see it. So zero, I'm sorry, zero, positive, one, negative. I'm done. So there is a solution between zero and one. So I'm going to say 0 and 1. Function is continuous on 0, 1. F of 0 is positive. F of 1 is negative. Therefore, and I have to put this in writing, therefore what? Therefore, by the intermediate value theorem, there exists a solution R in the open interval 1, 0, 1 such that f of R is, f of the root or the solution is, it's continuous and changes sign, and we are looking for a root. So what can it be? It's continuous, it changes sign, it crosses the x-axis. So f of r will be, of course, that's what we're trying to find. We're trying to find a solution. Very good. So what is our starting point then? It doesn't matter, you choose. You can start either at 0 or at 1. So where do we start? Okay, as long as f prime of 0 is not 0. Is f prime of 0, 0? No, very good, awesome. So now we have to create Newton's method, Newton of x. I will eventually move away from t, I don't know why. So this is x minus f of x, 3 cosine x minus 1, over negative 3 sine x minus 1. This is Newton's method. Do not delete what you already have in the graphing calculator. You'll see why, and we've done that a couple of times. Let's do it again. So in y equals, insert x minus parentheses. The numerator needs to be in parentheses. And divide by the derivative now, which is negative 3 sine x and minus 1. And close the parentheses. So now get out of there with second and quit. Are we okay? And go to variables. Go to y variables. Recall the function. Press enter. You said 0, okay, so that's the initial value. X sub 0 is 0. And we got 2. Then I will copy what I have, but over 0, I will overwrite 0 with the previous answer. And then I will repeat. I don't have to do anything anymore. Just repeat. We want 6 decimal digits. The first 3 are in order, but we need 3 more. I repeat. That's it. So 889470, even 4. I don't need this. This is good enough. So the method converged in, so we used x0, we got 2, 1, 2, 3, in 4 iterations. So I'm going to copy all these answers. So x sub 1 was 2, x sub 2, 0.8603639, x sub 3, 0.8897206, but x sub 4 is what I want, 0.889470. Because from this moment on, those will repeat forever. So 6 decimal digits, because the next one has the first 6 digits already. So we quickly reviewed L'Hopital's rule with a couple of examples, and we reviewed Newton's method. Are we okay with moving to the last section, 4.8 was Newton's method. 4.7, which is optimization. So this is the third application of differentiation. We had Newton's method. We had the first and the second derivative to graph a function completely with no calculator. And the third application is what we will cover today. Is that okay? Okay. So 4.7. Optimization. It's a huge part of math, optimization. Huge. What are we trying to do? We're trying to find max min of functions. But many times the function is not given to us. So we're going to look at the scenario. We're going to create the function, find its max min, show that it's max or min. Just finding a critical number does not say that that is a max or a min. We have to study the sign of the derivative. So that's what we're going to have to do. So let's start. We're going to start with a simple example. They are on page 332 and so on and so forth, starting with page 332. Okay, yes, 14. Here it is. A box with a square base. Sorry. A box with a square base and open top must have a volume of 32,000 cubic centimeters. Find the dimensions of the box that minimize the amount of material we used. So, a box with a square base and open top must have a volume of 32,000 cubic centimeters. Find the dimensions, length and width and height, but it's a square base, of the box that minimize the amount of material used. Okay. Good. So 14. We're given that the volume is 32,000 cubic centimeters, and we have this situation. We are told that the box has a square base. Okay, so x, 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 and it has a height, of course. It has an open top. And we're asked to minimize the amount of material used. What is that? Minimize what? What function is that about the material that we made this function, this box of? We are minimizing what? Very good. Thank you. We are minimizing the area, the total surface area or the area without the top because it doesn't have a lid. Perfect. So can anyone give us the surface area of this box except the top because it's open? It would be the base, which is x squared, and plus 4 of equal sides because the base is square, is the base is a square, so then all the sides will be the same. It will have the same area. What is the area of one side?
X times.
Very good. Perfect. So that's what I want to minimize, but I have a problem. And the problem I'm having is that this function has two variables in it. So one of them has to go away. Since I have an x squared and a 4xh, I would like h to go away somehow. I have a piece of information that I have not used yet. We're specifically told that the volume, what is the volume of this box? Very good. The volume is and has to be 32,000 cubic centimeters. And this is how I determine what? H. Very good. So solving this equation for H will give us 32,000 divided by x squared. And this is what I have to put in. I have to replace H in the surface area by 32,000 divided by x squared. Simplify as much as possible. I got the function. It's a function of one variable. What do you think we're going to do next after we simplify? So now I can say that S is a function of x only. So this will be x squared plus 4x times 32,000 divided by x squared. Of course, I'll simplify by 1x. So the simplified form is x squared plus 4 times 32,000, I think it's 128. I'm calculating again, yes. 128,000 divided by x because I simplified the x. So now S of x, the total surface area of this base with the, of this box with a square base, is this. Okay, now what? Say it again. Of course, thank you very much. Excellent. So let's find S prime. Can anyone give us S prime?
Sure.
Yes. And see how useful it is to remember how to differentiate 1 over x like this. What is it?
Negative 1.
Yes. 128,000 divided by? Excellent. Okay. So we created a function. We found its derivative. And now we want to find its minimum. So, what do I need to do? Yes, because I have to find what? It started with C. I need to find the critical numbers first. If they exist, then the function may have max min. If they don't exist, there is no max min. Unless it's a closed interval, yada, yada, yada. Okay, so the least common denominator is x squared. So this is 2x cubed minus 128,000. I have to simplify it first. And then I write S prime of x equals 0. When is a fraction 0? Numerator is 0. 2x cubed minus 128,000 equals 0. What type of equation is this? Very good. What do I need to do? It's a polynomial equation. So I will have to. Good. So this is x cubed equals 64,000. Okay, what now? Very good. Awesome. Indeed. The inverse function. I have to apply the inverse function. So then x equals in centimeters. And a 0. So the cube root of 1,000 is 10, and the cube root of 64 is 4. So now I claim I don't know. No idea where the t is coming from, but from now on, if I write t, is x. Okay, so I cannot claim anything. I can only say that 40 is a critical number. But if it turns out to be a max or a min, I don't know that yet. So I have to go back to S prime. I will not plug anything in here. How come I will not plug anything into x squared? Because it's always positive, so I'm not going to worry about it. So let's plug in 0 and give me the sign to the left of 40. So please plug in 0 and give me the sign to the left of 40. Okay, plug in 100. And give me the sign to the right of 40. Well, this is typical situation for what? Correct? Because it's less than 0, then it's 0, and then it's positive. So this is typical for a local min. In this case, absolute. Right? And absolute. Absolute min. What is the min? Let's suppose we're asked to. How do I find the minimum? I plug in the function what? Right? I have to plug in the function 40. So let's plug in the function. So here is s of 40, which is 40 squared plus 128,000 divided by 40. So I can simplify these two, right? And we had 3200, and 40 squared is this. So the absolute min will be, is it 4800? Measurement unit, please. Area. That's it. So this is your first problem with optimization. One more time, what the steps were. What were the steps? One, read the problem. Two, create a function of one variable. Try to get rid of anything else. Then differentiate this new function that we just created. Then find its, the function, what? Critical numbers. And then study the sign of the derivative left and right of the critical number to make sure that this gives a max or a min, whatever it is. Obviously, this is a min, because of the sequence of signs of the derivative. And that was it. Not too difficult. Yes, it can get hairy, of course. But on this one, not too difficult, right? Okay. So let's take a look. This time the function is given. Okay. Let's look at a problem like that. The rate in milligrams carbon per cubic meter per hour at which photosynthesis takes place for a species of, I think it's phytoplankton, I think, correct my pronunciation anytime, is modeled by the function, and this is given here, where I is the light intensity measured in thousands of foot candles. For what light intensity is P a maximum? So here, this particular problem, for this one, we don't have to find the function. The function, luckily, is given to us. Okay, so problem 10. So we don't have these many steps as we had before. The same step, long procedure. So this is problem 10 on the same page, 332. We're given P equals 100 I over I squared plus I and plus 4. So we are asked, what should I be, the light intensity, in thousands of foot candles? so that P is a maximum. Okay. What should we do? Much easier situation. We don't have to get rid of a variable. We don't have to find the function. The function is given to us. So what will be the first step? Correct. But before we find the critical number, we have to find the derivative. Very good. So P prime. Please do not make the mistake. This is not L'Hopital's rule. This is not a limit. We have to use the quotient rule. Okay, the top prime. So what I recommend, put the 100 outside. Don't mess with it. There is no need. It's a constant. It's a factor of the numerator. Take it out. The top function prime. So 100 is outside. Top function prime. 1 times I squared plus I plus 4 minus the top times the denominator prime over the denominator squared. What is the denominator prime? 2i plus 1. Excellent. Always try to simplify if you can. So there is no point in carrying that 100 over. There is no point. It can stay outside. It's a factor of the top. So now, distribute. Keep the 100 outside. You can wait patiently or not. Doesn't matter. It cannot have a voice. So I squared plus I plus 4 minus 2 I squared and minus I. Okay, luckily these two go away. So then we have 100. Negative 2 I squared plus I squared is negative I squared and then plus 4 over I squared plus I plus 4. Yes, of course, I'm going to factor out negative 1. I want it out of there. And I'm going to factor the numerator. How will you factor the numerator? Yes, I plus 2, I minus 2. So P prime is 0 when I is and I is. Okay, negative 2, which cannot be accepted, and 2, and one more time, the measurement unit was thousands of foot candles. Please. You cannot simply claim here I equals 2 gives a maximum. Nope, you can't. You have to show. So go back to a little table. So we have I, we have 2, we have P prime of I, and if we're interested, also P of I in here. So let me copy right here P prime of I equals negative 100 I plus 2 I minus 2 divided by I squared plus I plus 4, everything squared. And I'm going to say I refuse to plug in here anything. It's a waste of time. But I will plug in 0 here, keeping in mind that there is a minus. So when you plug in 0, what do you get? Or you can plug it into I squared minus 4, which is even easier. Negative. Times a negative. Very good. And now you can plug in 10 if you want. So 10 plus 2, 10 minus 2. Both will be positive, but there is a minus outside. So what will be the sign to the right of 2? Negative. What is this typical of? Yes, it is indeed local plus absolute max, and I can determine P of 2. So P of 2 is at the top 200 over 4 plus 2 plus 4. So 200 and this is 10, so this is 20. And the measurement unit for P was in milligrams carbon over m cubed per hour. That's the measurement unit. Questions? Okay, can I choose the next one? Okay. I'm looking at 34. Let's read 34. A poster is to have an area of 180 squared inches with 1-inch margins at the bottom and sides and 2 inches margin at the top. What dimensions will give the largest printed area? One more time. A poster is to have an area of 180 squared inches with 1-inch margins at the bottom and sides and 2 inches margin at the top. What dimensions will give the largest printed area? Okay. So this is 34, page 333. And here is the idea. X and Y. And the area is given to us to be 180 cubic inches. So obviously X times Y must be 180. That's our first equation. Now, the top 1-inch margins at the bottom and sides. So this is the printed area. Okay, one more time. What dimensions will give the largest printed area? So we know that this is 2 inches, and all around 1. Okay, so we know that the whole thing, the whole area is 180 squared inches. And we know that they require one inch margins everywhere except the top, which is 2. And we want to maximize the printed area. So what should this and this be so that this is maximum? But we are restricted. This area cannot be anything. It must be 180 squared inches. But how much should this be? How much should this be? This be width and length, width and height, if you want, so that this area, which now is clear, 2, 1, 1, 1, we can determine that, is maximum possible. So I need to maximize a function, but I don't have the function yet. So let's create the function. So, can anyone give us the printed area? Printed area. Say it again. Very good. Yes. Y minus 3 will be 2 and 1. So, this is indeed y minus 3, awesome. And this is indeed x minus 2. Do we all agree with this assessment? And that is the printed area. And that is the function that we have to maximize. However, you can say, wait a minute, it has two variables. One of them has to go away. Okay, so let's distribute first. So when I distribute, I get xy minus 3x minus 2y and plus 6. Well, this I can already replace by, very good. So then all I have to do is make this disappear somehow. Is there a way of making y disappear? Do I have anything that I could use to make y disappear? Right, so for y equals 180 over x. So this will be 180 over x. So now I can say that the printed area is a function of x only. Can anyone dictate that function? Don't calculate anything. We know we need everyone to see what's happening here. Minus 3x minus, very good, divided by x, that's it, awesome. So in this particular situation, I did not have the function. I had no choice but slowly determine the function step by step, come up with a graph, put the graph for the x and y, identify the margins, identify the printed area, and now I have a function that represents that printed area. There is no need to add the 6. You can. It's 186 minus 3x minus 360 over x. Because now we need to determine what? P printed area prime. So this goes away anyway. So negative 3, but now careful. When we differentiate negative 1 over x, we get, yes, positive, 360 over x squared. Because we already had a minus in front. Therefore, the next step would be to find the, yes, the least common denominator. And negative 3x squared plus 360. First, we have to simplify it, get into a product or a ratio. That's the first step. And now, the printed area prime equals 0. So I highly recommend factor out the negative 3 to make it so much easier, and then x squared minus 120 divided by x squared. So there are two possibilities. X equals the square root of 120, or x equals negative the square root of 120 in centimeters. So yes, it's easy to plug it in the calculator, but it's more important to be able to come up with the exact expression. So when we have x equals the square root of 120, the best thing to do is, well, I see this is 12 times 10, right? So this is 4 times 3, and this is 2 times 5. So there is really nothing else. I can only take out a 2. So it's 2, the square root of 6 times 5, which is 30 centimeters. And yes, you can approximate it if you want to. Now, what about y? I have to go back to, remember it was 180 divided by x. So then y will be 180 divided by 2, the square root of 30. And we simplify, and we get 90 divided by the square root of 30, but we have to rationalize using the square root of 30. So this is 90, the square root of 30 over 30. Nice. So this is 3, the square root of 30 centimeters. So it appears we have not checked anything yet. So for now, we'll say 2, the square root of 30 centimeters, and 3, the square root of 30 centimeters. But we don't know. So I have to use x, 0, 2, the square root of 30, and PA prime of x is 0. I'm going to copy PA prime right here. So PA prime of x is negative 3x squared minus 120 over x squared. And of course, I'm not going to plug in anything in there. So I want to plug in 0, so please plug in 0. There is a minus here, there is a minus here. What do we get on this side when we plug in 0? Very good. And let's say we plug in 1,000. 1,000 squared will be much larger than this, so this quantity becomes positive, but there is a minus in front. What is this typical of? Max. In case we want to determine the max, we have to plug in 2 the square root of 30. So remember the area is this. So in here, I can plug in 30. So P of 30 equals a PA of 30 is 186 minus, minus 3 times 3 times 2 the square root of 30, and then minus 360 over 2 the square root of 30. And that will be the maximum here, the y value. Any questions?